Blog Talk Radio.
AC Butch here for his first ever show. Well, actually, this is two premieres in one day. I started my Lee Elvis AC Butch show this afternoon at 12 o'clock on Blog Talk Radio. So two for one, not bad, let me tell you. But anyway, in the meantime, let's kind of get to know each other. Let's go way, way back to the beginning. Bay Ridge, Brooklyn, in the 1940s. I tell you, that was really a scene. It was kind of like something out of the Bowery Boys. I lived on Fifth Avenue. There was a trolley car. Oh, yeah, a trolley car. A lot of you people don't even know what that is, right? Ran right down in front of my house. I lived above a carpet store. I tell you. This place was a piece of work, to say the least. Everything went on there. I mean, I was just a total street kid. I'm not even going into half the things that I did, not even a tenth of them. But I'll tell you, I really had a ball. And at 10 years old, though, I moved to what I considered the farmlands. Yeah, Bensonhurst. We went on. It was the last street, I think, in Brooklyn that was still a dirt road. No sidewalks, no anything. Our neighbors across the street had chickens in the backyard and a goat or whatever it might be and some other stuff, and I couldn't even sleep. Let me tell you, it was so quiet at night, I literally laid in bed, and I got insomnia that stayed with me, I think, for the next, it stayed with me for the next 40 years or so, maybe even longer than that, next 50 years, until I ended up with narcolepsy, and I couldn't stay awake then. That was in the late 80s. But I started actually getting into gambling because, you know, AC Butch, Atlantic City, so on and so forth. And, yeah, a lot of people ask me if Butch is my real name. It's my real nickname. Going way back, my mother nicknamed me that when I was a little toddler. And AC, of course, fits in with Atlantic City. That's after my Brooklyn days, which was really only up until, 7, 8 years ago, although I did have a condo in Margate Towers part-time. When I say part-time, I mean we only stayed in it occasionally. But I got that in the late 80s, right on the Atlantic Ocean. Fantastic, fantastic place. But even when we had that, we spent most of the time in the casinos between my gambling, and we booked great lounge acts. We brought them in from New York. That's the whole story within itself, let me tell you. It wasn't an easy deed getting in with these booking agents from the different hotels. It took a long time, a lot of money spent. Oh, yeah. But once we did, I tell you, we had a ball. And at the Taj, that was something else. We landed the cream de mint to the cream de mint. When they first opened up, Donald Trump, I don't know if you people know or remember, but he threw this lavish party, flew in 3,000 big shots, stars, you name it, and everything from Michael Jackson, the heavyweight champion of the world, I think it was Michael Spinks at the time I was with him, I should know. And we got to book it, our band, just us, from Brooklyn. 7 great-looking Italian studs that could really sing. They had their shit together. They were together already about 7 years or so, and they did a lot of the 50s, 60s, so on and so forth, but they were phenomenal. They just looked good. They had everything together, and they captured the act that every agent was looking to get. The band to open the grand opening party. Oh, yeah. I was there. Yeah, me and my wife, I tell you, what a ball, what a ball. And then they got an engagement the first 6 weeks. The first 6 weeks at the Casbah Lounge, which was the most beautiful thing. I think the most gorgeous lounge in the world. And they went on to play in every major casino, all the big lounges in Atlantic City for the next few years, and they were just a sellout every single time. As a matter of fact, the casinos complained sometimes that they were bringing in too much. They wanted the people out gambling and not disturbing anything, so actually that worked in the reverse. But anyway, my gambling casino days started, of course, in the 70s, But going way back to the 50s, the late 50s, I became an action bowler at around 13 years old. Oh, and I loved it. Let me tell you. I was real good in sports. I was real good in sports, but it just grabbed me. I actually started playing poker at 10 years old, 11 years old. My father had a weekly game. His friends would come over. And it wasn't really a small game. I mean, it was 25 and 50 cents. And at that time, grown men were making $40, $50 a week as their pay, and they supported a family on it. So a 25, 50-cent game was not gigantic, but it was sizable. And right from the beginning, I just had some kind of a knack for it. And I started winning, and my father would let me play a lot. When I was 13 years old, he also got me into bowling down at Ovington Lanes at the time in Bay Ridge, even though we had already moved to Bensonhurst. I could bowl every day for free. Anytime I just wanted to get on the bus and go down there, I could bowl for free. There was pin boys, the real old thing, and he would take care of them at the end of the week. He was in really tight with the owner. The place consisted of actually 20 bowling alleys, 10 upstairs and 10 downstairs. That was a lot for those days. A really big bar that was a whole business within itself, and a big luncheonette that was a whole business within itself. Great food, hot dogs. Boy, I tell you, I had my cheeseburger, my french fries, a soda, a great dill pickle, 50 cents, outrageous, loved it. But at 13 years old, he put me into a match with Jimmy Nolan. Jimmy Nolan was a lefty who worked at Ovington, was the head pin chaser, big, big, big hooky, threw fantastic. Nobody could beat Jimmy. Nobody could beat Jimmy at Ovington Lanes. And it was the last night of the league, and I was bowling for my father. And I already became a pretty good bowler. I'm shooting like a 176 average at Ovington, which is a really hard house. And that's a pretty good average for those days. But we were going up against Jimmy's team, and we had a shot. We had a shot to win the championship, but we had to sweep all three games against his team next to impossible. P.S., the impossible happens. We sweep all three games. We take first place. I shot really good, and my father and Jimmy got into a little bit of a mouthing-off contest. Jimmy's a hard-headed Irish kid. My father's a hard-headed Swede, and one thing led to the other, and Jimmy's put me down, and my father said, put your money where your mouth is. My son will bowl you. I said, oh, I'll tell you, I felt like saying to my father, which I would, are you crazy? But anyway, he was smart enough to set the match up for this brand-new house that I had never bowled in up on 88th Street, Lemark Lanes. And because even though Ovington was my house, you can't bowl Jimmy Nolan at Ovington. My father knew it. So we go up to Lee Market. I walk into this place, a joint like I've never been in before. Gigantic place, brand new, just a whole completely different atmosphere than Ovington. And we're going to bowl a three-game match, total wood, for $50. A lot of money. Well, when I get up there to throw my first ball, my knees are shaking. They're knocking. And I was so nervous. I was shaking. I didn't have a pop. Okay. But anyway, the ball goes off my ankle and somehow ends up being a strike. And Jimmy throws a split, misses it. And that just took the edge off. I went on to bowl in the best three games of my life. First of all, I never shot scores like that because in Ovington you just can't do it. I couldn't believe how easy the house was. I shot a 277 that first game. I came back with like a 258. 256, whatever it was. And my third game, I believe, was in the 230s or 240s. I shot a 7-plus, win the whole thing. My father ends up giving me the whole 50 in singles plus $50 from winning the league, also in 50s. I got 100 big in my pocket. The next day, I go into Avenue M feeling like a king. My bowling ball in my hand, don't know a soul in there. Again, a brand-new house, but not as fancy as Lemark. And this was my introduction to Avenue M. I would basically live there throughout my teenage years. The best, I'll tell you. I only wish I could live them over because I appreciate it, but I could even appreciate it more now. And then finally, well, I'm going to go into so much more a little bit later on. I ended up going into the service when I was 18, ended up being in only one year, the Air Force. We'll get into that story sometime. And then I went to work for the post office. I came out, and I don't even know why I was working. I got involved with a girl, and I don't even know why I was working. I should have just been bowling for money because I was more than capable of making a living. At 17 years old, let me tell you something. My website, actionbowlers.com, has all the stories on it, tons and tons of stories. I've done videos, so on and so forth. And I was shooting really good bowls, some really, really big matches, took down some heavy-duty cash, and I go into the service, yeah, because I quit high school, didn't have the nerve to face my father, and that was basically it. That was the reason for doing it, and I ran away. Sweetie, what? Oh, okay. Okay, yeah, let me just finish up with the radio show. I'll take you out. Don't worry about it. Okay. You get married. Okay, this is my second time around, but I'm already in there for 25 years.